So that intro was a little piece that I put together recently with my man Cliff for Camelback, and I figured I'd use it as an example in today's video. I've made two of these tips for better editing videos in the past, and they cover everything from color grading and stabilizing footage to sound design and music choices. And those are post-production, but they're technically not editing. Editing is nothing more than where you choose to cut, which clips you decide to use, and how you arrange them on the timeline. So in today's video, I want to go very basic and give you 10 tips for better editing, just cutting your clips for the best structure and pacing and storytelling. This video is also sponsored by my good friends over at ArtGrid, so a big thank you to them up top. But that being said, let's waste no time, jump right on in, talking about making it as easy as possible for your computer to play back your footage. Editing is all about watching the same thing over and over again and feeling out tiny little adjustments, and a single frame can make a big difference. So if you're constantly waiting on your computer to load your footage, it makes the entire process slower and less accurate. There are a few things you can do to make that playback faster. One is using proxies, which are basically just smaller versions of your clip that are used during the editing process, and I'll link a video in the description and in the cards that'll show you how to make those. You can also try lowering the playback resolution or using what's called global effects mute, which basically just turns off all of the effects on the timeline while you're editing. But regardless, it's worth sacrificing quality for performance while you're making those small adjustments. Another way you can make the process much faster before you even start editing is to get really good with your keyboard shortcuts. Editing is about making a lot of monotonous little motions and tweaks, and keyboard shortcuts can make this way faster. So dig into your editing software settings and set custom keyboard shortcuts that make the most sense for you, and then make sure to use those when you're editing. Get used to them and build up that habit and muscle memory, and it will save you a lot of time down the line. Okay, but that's enough about processors and keyboard shortcuts. Let's talk about some actual editing techniques, starting out with dividing the edit into sections. This makes it easier for you to work out the edit because it's easier to look at a single sequence and figure out how you're going to arrange the clips than it is to approach an entire video and do the same thing. And it also just makes the video more understandable for the viewer. So if we take a look at the intro to this video, there are three prominent sequences. There's the waterfall sequence at the beginning, a hiking sequence in the middle, and then finally a camping sequence at the end. And those just made it much easier for me to approach the edit because I wasn't trying to figure out how to arrange all of the footage at once. I was separating it out into three different pools and looking at those individually. Having sequences like this is really useful, but if you're working this way, you want to make sure not to leave a gap in the edit. So like an abrupt jump from one sequence right to another with nothing connecting the two. Looking again at the intro to this video, if I were to just jump from hiking footage straight to camping footage, then that would be a bit of an abrupt cut. So instead, to bridge that gap, I've included this quick little sequence showing the camp being set up. In that case, we planned ahead and had the footage that we needed, but sometimes you don't. And if you're in one of those situations where you have a gap that you need to find some way to bridge in the edit, then a great option is using some stock footage. And that brings me to the sponsor of today's video, which is ArtGrid. ArtGrid is a massive library of amazing stock footage shot by filmmakers all over the world, with new material added every single day. It's also really simple because they have one license that covers everything. Commercial use, your client's use of the footage, there's no limits on the number of views or the audience size you can share that footage with, and you can even continue to use the footage if you don't renew your subscription. There are three plans based on the quality of footage that you need to download. So for just $25 a month, you can download anything in their library in HD. For $40 a month, you can download it in 4K and 8K, and for $50 a month, you can download it in log and even sometimes raw. Bridging a gap in the edit is a perfect example of how I use stock footage in my own work. Being able to just toss in like a drone shot, a time lapse, a shot of a car driving, and bridge those two sequences, whenever I need something like that, ArtGrid comes in clutch. So if you want to try it out for yourself, there will be a link in the description of this video, and you can sign up through that link and get an additional 2 months completely free. That being said, let's now move on and zoom in a bit, moving from the more broad approach to editing to now look at the specific individual cuts. Firstly, and this is a big one, if you're editing with music in the background of your video, don't always cut on the beat. Sure, it's a good reference to keep in mind and to follow the flow of the music in general, but if you cut right on that beat too frequently, then the pacing of your video becomes way too predictable. And if you're just cutting right on the beat no matter what, then you might actually end up with more jarring cuts by not considering the contents of the clip. To give you an example, there's a cut in the intro to this video that's actually the transition between two sequences, and I didn't cut right on the beat. I actually cut a few frames earlier so that this sleeping bag hitting his shoulder would fall on the beat. I thought that made a little more sense and highlighted the motion of the clip more than having the cut fall on the beat. And that's the kind of thing that I keep an eye out for when I'm going through my footage and putting together an edit. I'm looking for those little motions and impacts within the shot that could also fall on the beat. So probably the most common example is if I have a shot of someone walking, then instead of cutting the shot right on the beat, I'll cut it a little earlier so that the moment their foot hits the ground falls on the beat instead. And that's just a slightly more creative, slightly more natural way to cut that footage. Another technique to keep in mind for more natural cuts between your clips is to cut on impact and motion. Large impacts and motions within the shot motivate your cuts and will give them a more natural flow if you use them correctly. I have these two shots of Cliff filling a bottle up with water, and if you look closely, you'll notice how the cuts in those two shots are motivated by the impacts within the clip. To give you another example, I have these two shots in the beginning of the video where the upwards motion of the camera combined with the motion of the bottle coming out of the water creates a natural cut between them. If you're looking for impacts and motions and points in the shot that you can place a cut on, one really useful technique is to use markers to keep track of those and kind of edit around them. You can use these to line up the same motion on two shots for continuity between them, or to mark like an impact or a spot in the shot so that you can then edit around it. And they're also obviously just useful for making little notes about the edit, like if there's a license plate, I'll make sure to use a marker and make sure to go blur it out before I finish the edit. Moving on, it's also good to maintain consistent motion between shots. For example, everything in a sequence moving from left to right or pushing in. A lot of that comes down to which clips you decide to use and how you order them, but it can also be as simple as just reversing a shot or using a horizontal flip effect so that it moves in the opposite direction. Going back to this example from the intro, I animated a little bit of an upward camera motion on the first shot so that it would flow a little more seamlessly into the second one. And that similar motion makes those two clips flow very well together. Next up, let's talk about a technique that I use all the time, including in the intro to this video, and that is cutting your music to your video rather than cutting your video to your music. So that's a little confusing, but let me explain. So sometimes you run out of clips, but you still have a minute of music left on the timeline, and you have two options in this scenario, right? You can either go add in some more shots that you don't like and lengthen the ones that you already have, which will of course result in a boring and much worse edit, or you can just find a creative way to cut the track and make it shorter. Music is inherently very repetitive and structured, so you can usually find some way to cut it to your liking. So a lot of the time I'll just cut out a section of a song, like finding two similar beats and deleting everything in between them and then fading them together and nobody ever notices. And in the case of the intro to this video, it was even more simple. I just cut the song to start a couple minutes in. So I found a spot that had a nice build to it, used that right at the beginning, and then there's only a minute of the song left, so it suits that 1 minute video. How you do this really depends on the track you're using, but there's almost always a way to make it work. And finally, possibly the most important tip in this video is to not fumble the ending. A problem with a ton of travel films is that they get to the end of the edit and they've either run out of footage or haven't thought through how they want to wrap the video up. So you just have this kind of awkward, abrupt ending that leaves a bad taste in your mouth as a viewer. There's nothing more satisfying than a great ending, and there's nothing more unsatisfying than a bad one. So before you even start editing, sit down and plan out how you want to wrap your video up. That could mean saving some of the best footage for the very end, making sure not to use it, or planning out some final sequence that closes out the video. But no matter what, you cannot afford to fumble the ending. So in the intro to this video, I wanted the ending to kind of calmly slow down and close out an otherwise quite fast-paced video. So I made sure that the cuts in that final sequence are a good bit slower, finally leading up to this very slow, calm, longer ending shot of the landscape. And that's just yet another example of something that has a massive impact on the quality of your edit and is decided in the very earliest, most basic stages of that edit. That early stage of editing is something that we don't talk nearly as much about, but it's the foundation of a really good edit. Like, as good as your color grading and effects and sound design are, if you fumble this part, there's a good chance the video is gonna come crumbling down regardless of what you do afterwards. So it's important to make sure you have the knowledge and experience and just invest the time in making sure that you're deliberate with those very basic cuts. They're basic, but they're incredibly important. And I hope this video has given you a good jumping off point if you're new to this and haven't thought much about it before, or has given you, if you're a little more experienced, hopefully still some new tips and techniques to try out in your own work. So that being said, thank you again to the homies at ArtGrid for sponsoring this one. Thank you to all of you for watching it. I can't wait to see you in the next one.